Okay, do you want to be blown away and confused at the same time? As a video creator, this i5-12600K is better than the 5950X and costs less than half the price. Now, said that, I think this i5-12600K is enough of a CPU for like 95% of the people. I think I need to explain.
Motion Array is a fantastic tool for creators to make better videos and faster. Motion Array has over 80,000 premium quality templates, presets, plugins, music and sound effects, stock video and photos. In a nutshell, it is a one-stop shop for all your video post-production needs. Configure the membership to suit your needs. Pay annually, monthly, cancel anytime you want, and enjoy your unlimited downloads. Not sure about Motion Array? Go try out the hundreds of free assets available on the website. Check out Motion Array in the video description below.
Absolutely freezing in here. Let's wear appropriate clothing.
This is actually a really nice and comfortable hoodie.
So then the 12600K, let's talk about the specs. The specs that actually mean anything, not just some random gigahertz stuff that doesn't make a difference or no one knows what the heck it means. So the retail price for this is around $300. There's 10 cores, 6 of them are performance cores and 4 of them are efficiency cores. Altogether there's 16 threads because the performance cores have 2 threads per core, whereas the efficiency cores have 1 thread per core. The TDP is 125 watts, yet the turbo boost is 150 watts. It does support DDR4 and DDR5, and it's got the same IGBU inside as the i7 and i9, which is the UHD 770. Before we jump into the performance benchmarks, we need to look at the testing setup. For the 12th gen, we are using exactly the same setup we use for the 12900K. If you haven't seen that review yet, go check it out on my channel. But basically the motherboard is ASUS Z690 Creator Wi-Fi motherboard. We're using the ROG Ryujin 360mm AIO cooler to cool it down. We're using 64GB of DDR5 from Kingston. Although we can't run it at 5200MHz because the system is unstable at 5200 and we have to drop it down to 4800MHz and CL38, which is still pretty impressive. For SSDs, we're using Seagate FireCuda 530. The GPU is the ASUS TUF RTX 1390 and it's tested on an open test bench. And for the comparisons for the AMD build, we're using the ASUS X570 ProArt Creator motherboard. We're using 64GB of DDR4 from Kingston. That's running at 3600MHz CL18. The GPU is the same RTX 3090. It's basically the same PC we just built, the X570 ProArt, if you haven't seen that one. And for the 11th gen, we're using exactly the same main components, like the RAM is the same, the GPU is the same, but just the motherboard is Maximus Hero 13. Everything else is the same as on the AMD system. So let's jump into the benchmarks then. By the way, this channel is focused on creators, so we are focusing only on the creative-centered benchmarks. If you want to check out how good this is at gaming, I highly recommend you check out Optimum Tech's video of the 12600K. We're gonna start with Cinebench R23. Even though being generic and synthetic benchmark, it actually does give us quite a good useful information how good this CPU is in Cinema 4D. The 5950X in multi-core performance is 62.4% better, and the 12900K is 54.9% better, which is very well balanced considering that the 12900K is pretty much exactly double the price of this i5. The Ryzen 5900X is 19.6% faster, although the best of last generation, the 11900K, is 15% slower. Just for comparison, the M1 Max is 30% slower and the Ryzen 5600X is 40.5% slower. In terms of single core in Cinebench R23, the 12900K is 10.7% faster, yet the 11900K is 8.3% slower, the 5950X 8.7% slower, and the 5900X 12.9% slower, and the M1 Max processor is 15.8% slower, the 5600X, which is 18.4% slower. Moving on to Geekbench 5, which basically gives us an idea how good the processor is in generic everyday tasks. The 12900K is 43.5% faster than the 12600K. 5950X from Ryzen is 35.9% faster, 5900X is 13.5% faster.
The M1 Max here, interestingly, is 1.2% faster. I do think Geekbench favors Apple here a little bit because all the Max seems to be getting very high scores in the Geekbench scores. The 11900K though is 13.8% slower and the 5600X 33.4% slower. Now on the single core side though, the 12900K is 7.4% faster and interestingly enough, the 11900K is slightly faster than the 12600K, which wasn't the case on the Cinebench R23 single core scores. The M1 Max is 3.1% slower, the 5900X is 7.8% slower and the 5950X 8.1% slower, and the 5600X is 13.6% slower. Let's move on to photo editing and Photoshop then. And on top of the chart, we have the 12900K, and that is 15.2% faster than the 12600K. The 5950X is 6.2% faster than the 12600K. 11900K is 3% slower, and the Ryzen 5900X is 4.9% slower. Bear in mind the 5900X and 5600X have an RTX 3070 instead of 3090, but in Photoshop and Lightroom, it basically makes 0% difference. So that's why those scores are still irrelevant. The Ryzen 5600X is 11.8% slower, and the poor M1 Max is 30.8% slower than the 12600K. Now Lightroom Classic. The Intel 12900K is on top of the bunch over here and 19.4% faster than the 12600K. Ryzen 5950X is 7.9% faster and the 5900X is 1.3% faster. Now the 11900K is 11.9% slower than the 12600K. Ryzen 5600X is 13.6% slower. Because we don't have a benchmark for the M1 Max from Apple, I've included the Ryzen 5700G just on its own without the dedicated GPU, and that is 18.9% slower than the 12600K. The reason those high core count CPUs get high overall score here in Lightroom Classic is because Lightroom Classic measures active and passive scores. The high core count CPUs can actually export the photos much faster, which lifts the overall scores, whereas their active score where actually working on the photos might be slightly lower because that is more dependent on the single core performance of the CPU. Regardless, looking at the benchmarks, to be only 1.3% behind the 5900X is seriously impressive in photo editing. Moving on to video editing and Premiere Pro. The 12900K is 12.2% faster than the 12600K, but the Ryzen 5950X is 0.7% slower because of the 12600K. The 11900K is 7.1% slower, M1 Max is 21% slower, the Ryzen 5900X is 27.6% slower, but bear in mind the 5900X doesn't have an RTX 3090, but only RTX 3070, and the same case is with the Ryzen 5600X, which is 44.3% slower than the 12600K when running an RTX 3070. The reason it's so good at video editing is the iGPU inside this tiny little chip. Because the UHD 770 has an actually two media engine, which are video decoders and encoders inside the chip, which make a massive difference in the timeline video playback speed, especially with H.264 and 265 codecs. I highly recommend you check out the timeline performance of the 12600K, and you can see that when using H.265 10-bit 422 4K 60 frames per second from Canon R5, this little chip breezes through like butter when editing on the timeline, which is insane and is so much better than any of the NVIDIA encoders or decoders. In fact, it's even better than the Threadripper processors, which is absolutely insane. Unfortunately, I can't help you at After Effects because PewDiePie changed their benchmarking score and baseline score, which means that basically all my old CPUs that I had on loan or temporarily was using, all of my older benchmarks mean nothing, so I can't give you a comparison how good this is over there. But on DaVinci Resolve, on the other hand, we see a similar situation as on Premiere Pro. The 12900K is on top of the bunch and is 8.9% faster than the 12600K. The Ryzen 5950X is slightly slower than the 12600K, only by 0.1%, but this is an average of multiple tests done, so it averages slightly slower. The 11900K is 5.8% slower, the 5900X is 14% slower, 5600X is 21% slower. And because we don't have an M1 Max score for the DaVinci Resolve, because that benchmark doesn't work on Apple Silicon, we included the Intel 11600K i5 from previous generation, and that is 25.3% slower than the 12600K. So as you can see, if you're a video editor, this 12600K is absolutely amazing, especially for the price point. Moving on to 3D work and rendering, we have Blender over here, and we have a classroom benchmark, and on top of the chart, we have the 5950X, which really shines how good those 16 performance cores from AMD are. It's 15.5% faster than the 12600K. The 12900K is just slightly behind at 12.2% faster than the 12600K. Interestingly enough, the 12600K with 10 cores beat out the 5900X with 12 performance cores and is 3.2% faster. Now moving on to the best of last generation of Intel, 11900K is 75% slower than the 12600K. That's ridiculous. The M1 Max is 107% slower than the 12600K, and the 5600X is 119% slower than the 12600K. When moving on to a longer rendering benchmark from Blender, which is the Victor benchmark, which is the longest, we can see that the Ryzen 5950X extends its lead even further, which is 46.5% faster than the 12600K. The 12900K is 36.8% faster, and now the 12-core Ryzen 9 5900X is 34% faster than the 12600K. Interestingly enough, the 10900K from two generations ago, which also has 10 cores, is 9.1% faster than the 12600K. On this Blender test, we can see that the 10 performance cores from 10900K are better than the 10 hybrid cores from 12600K. The 11900K is 13.5% slower than the 12600K, and 5600X is 32.8% slower. So now the thermals and heat. This is 125 watts TDP and boosts up to 150 watts. In fact, I didn't really see 150 watts pulled ever from the socket. So it runs somewhere around that, between 125 and 140 or somewhere around there. And that is completely fine. On this Ryujin 360mm, it was constantly sitting around 60°C, which I'm very happy with, maybe in the low 70s, so no problem over there. Now, in comparison, if you look at the AMD side, like the 5600X, which is much cooler and runs only at 65W TDP, our i5-12600K is much hotter, but at the same time, we're much better as well, so there's that. Although, you do have to have a better cooler on the 12600K than the Ryzen 5 5600X. Now, let's talk about the price, because the news over here aren't as good as they seem like, because the 12th gen system cost is much higher because of the lower availability of DDR5, and the Z690 motherboards cost much more than the equivalent in Z590 or X570. So on this chart, you can see different system costs for 12900K, 5900X, 5950X, 11900K, and the 12600K. With the same motherboard, the motherboard I used in this example was the MSI Unify X570 and the Z590 and the Z690. So even though the pricing of the CPU is impressive at only $300, which is much cheaper than the 5900X and 5950X, yet the performance is right up there with the Ryzen 9s. But the overall system cost of the 12600K is only about $50 to $75 cheaper than the 5900X. Yet, we're pretty much the same on photo editing, or slightly better. We're better at video editing, but worse for rendering and 3D stuff, and that's compared to the 5900X. Bear in mind, the benchmark results in this review have been made with the DDR5. For photo editing, the DDR4 doesn't make that much of a difference, but it does for video editing. I'll get into the DDR4 versus DDR5 in another video. I'm still completing some of my benchmark systems just over there. So in conclusion, yes, the performance of the 12600K is super, super impressive. And I think for 95% of the people, the 12600K is enough of a CPU for a good few years. Unless you really do some 3D work and rendering, then you might opt for the higher core count CPUs. But for video editing, this is more than enough. Especially if you're doing up to 4K video editing, the performance for this 12600K is absolutely insane. In fact, it's as good as it can get. And depending on the codec, if it's accelerated on the hardware on this iGPU, it's much better than the Ryzen 9s and even Threadripper systems. And it's the same with photo editing. Because of the single core performance of this 12600K, we're getting very high scores. It does slack slightly behind the Ryzen 9s when it comes to exporting of the photos, but when working on the photos, this is plenty for you. And if you are a photographer, you can utilize the iGPU inside there and don't need to cash out for an expensive graphics card. Just use the iGPU inside and you're not gonna see a difference between a dedicated graphics card and this iGPU in there. Now, the downside is the i5 doesn't cost like the usual i5s. The system cost is right up there with Ryzen 9s. And when we're talking about DDR5, which is rarer than illegal Russian caviar and costs at least 3 times the amount of fast DDR4, the price isn't so appealing. But I expect the DDR5 to become more and more available soon, since all the RAM vendors and manufacturers are moving on to production of DDR5 from DDR4, and AMD will also be switching to DDR5 soon, so there's good hopes for the DDR5. So all in all, the 12600K is very impressive, especially for creators, and when we're seeing that it's sharing punches with the Ryzen 9s, especially with video editing, it really raises some eyebrows. And even though the performance of this chip with DDR4 is slightly slower or lower than DDR5, I still think it's worth it. Since you're gonna get a lot of specs from the Z690 platform compared to some of the Ryzen systems, like it's usual to see 4 M.2 slots at PCIe 4.0 speeds, and the upgrade path for this 12600K is very, very bright. You can go i7, i9s, and most likely the next generation is gonna be on the same platform, so you have a lot of upgradability, and the performance right now is super impressive. If you're wondering which DDR4 motherboard to go for this 12600K, then I highly recommend you check out my review of the Gigabyte Aero G DDR4 motherboard that I have released on my channel. I'll also leave the motherboard in the description below, as well as this 12600K if you wanna pick them out. Helpful links in the description below. Likes if you enjoyed it, subs if you'd like to see more, and I'll meet you in the comment section below. Bye bye.